the amazing Sundarbans, world's largest estuarine forest and mangrove expanse, featuring a unique ecosystem that experiences two high tides and two ebb tides every day. A system that supports several unique species of life. And human habitation spread over 54 out of 102 islands, who earn their livelihood from the waters, the forests, and the land. Despite all its natural wealth and its importance in regional and planetary ecology, the Sundarbans is a fragile and very vulnerable ecosystem, prone to increasingly intense real-life threats. This has earned the Sundarbans the anxious title of Desperate Delta. For years, we have witnessed a growing threat to the Sundarbans, part climatic, part man-made. The ebbs and tides are stronger than before. Decades-old embankments can no longer hold back the onrush of saline waters, and these have led to dangerous erosion and breaching of embankments. Rising sea levels induced by climate change, mangrove depletion has compounded the damage. And the constant struggle for livelihood of local people indulges them to unsustainable means. On the 25th of May 2009, a cyclonic storm, Aila, hit the Sundarban coast. It was a result of a depression in the Bay of Bengal, routine during end summer and pre-monsoon season. Aila wasn't particularly ferocious, with wind speeds calculated at 80 to 100 kilometers an hour in the Sundarbans area. But what it did over a 24-hour period left the Sundarbans and the rest of Bengal gasping. damage was nothing short of phenomenal. And despite meteorological warnings, it caught everyone unprepared. Overnight, millions became eco-refugees, destitutes without home or hearth. Thousands of homes were obliterated. Thousands of people and livestock perished. A saline curse was marked on the stored grain. Fields full of betel leaf, crops and vegetables destroyed as saline waters flooded them, and freshwater ponds and rainwater reservoirs with not even drinking water. To top the hurt, whatever had been painstakingly built over time, livelihoods, mangrove plantations, tube wells, water body renewal work, and medical camps, everything was shattered, swept away, rendered useless. Now we know, and the world knows, even the skeptics grudgingly admit it, that climate change is real and is irreversible. We cannot arrest its advance, but we can adapt. We can be prepared. We need to build and rebuild the embankments, make them stronger with built-in safeguards.
Sundarban, being an eco-fragile and eco-sensitive area, built on alluvial accretion over ages and geologically new, the landform is apt to change frequently. So I must say that there should not be any constructions like concrete embankments. And there are speculations about trying different technologies, like using geotubes. But the material of which these geotubes are made is polyamide or polyethylene and other petrochemical derivatives. And their eco-compatibility is questionable. So we must go in for some natural geotextiles. And I think jute geotextile will suit the requirement because of its inherent features like water absorption, drainage capability, and high roughness coefficient, which facilitates transference of load to the soil. Regarding the way it is being repaired now, the bans, mostly by villagers, they are just putting up some soil lumps, and there is no compaction, there is no consolidation as such. So these are all vulnerable.
We have experienced again how mangroves have protected the embankments, and in its absence they have been flattened. We need to implement disaster mitigation schemes, build cyclone shelters, establish secure grain banks, create freshwater storage systems, distribute medical kits.
Now see, in Aila, the effect started from Bay of Bengal, but it did not do any damage to Sundarban mangrove system. hardly a few deer died, but otherwise there was no effect. No tiger died, no major animal died, or even minor animals did not die. But outside forest, hundreds of cattle died. Now, in this situation, we know that mangrove is very, very important. Had mangrove not been there, maybe the impact will be much more. So, the best method for this will be not to erect embankments just on the river bed. It should be little away from the bank, and in the meantime, there should be some mangrove plantations. Wherever there were mangrove plantations, there was little damage. Wherever the embankment was on the river, even if that was fully pakka construction, there was lot of damage.
We need to revitalize the livelihood of human communities. We need to build homes for the homeless.
এখন যখন আমরা রিকনস্ট্রাকশন করব তখন আমরা আবার একটু অন্যভাবে চিন্তা ভাবনা করছি কি করে ভবিষ্যতে এই ধরনের যদি ডিজাস্টার হয় সেটাকে অ্যাভয়েড করা যায়। তার জন্য এবারে বিল্ডিংগুলোকে আমরা চিন্তা করছি যে একটু উঁচু করে বানানো, যাতে যে অন্তত 10-12 ফুট জল হলেও সেই যাতে বিল্ডিংয়ের সেরকম কোনো ক্ষতি না হয়।
ইন হাউজিং, হাউস ইজ আ প্রোডাক্ট, হ্যাঁ, অ্যান্ড হাউজিং ইজ দি টোটাল প্রসেস। ইউ নিড টু প্রোভাইড ইনফ্রাস্ট্রাকচার, services, community facilities, so that a housing can grow, a community can grow.
And overwhelmingly, we must establish awareness at all levels, inspire and motivate community participation through ownership of various actions.
There is a need for a lot of work. The community has to be involved in the whole process, because there must be a sense of community ownership of who will manage it after the external organizations and the government withdraws. Any donor agency which tries to come in with funding has to come with an open mind. Sundarbans' vulnerability is of a total different dimension. It's a permanent vulnerability. It's a vulnerability which is not, you know, a cyclone once in 6, 8 years or 10 years like Orissa. It's not a vulnerability where you have a major tsunami after 20, 30 years. It's a vulnerability which will go on monthly, periodically, along with every tidal wave that comes in, and especially with very major tidal waves.